So good afternoon, good evening. While I'm just digesting my breakfast in Belgium, I would like to share the experience of the Aitje banana team in breeding Matoke bananas, which are in fact the highland cooking bananas of Eastern Africa. My talk has basically four messages. First of all, banana breeding is possible. The second message is that we are soon going to release new hybrids in Tanzania, and soon means either this year or next year. Number three, it's because of the close collaboration between the national programs in Uganda and Tanzania and Aitje and another range of partners that we were able to do that. And lastly, the point is that I think we have now a breeding system. It means that if people drop out, the breeding will continue. Next slide, please. So the yield of the highland cooking bananas of Eastern Africa, grown above 1,000 meters above sea level, is very low. You see that the yield is about 5 to 30 tons per hectare, and we can achieve 70 tons if we start changing the way we are farming and the use of varieties. Next slide, please. But the low yields are caused by pests and diseases. Pests and diseases which are invade the farms, but also which are being transmitted through the planting material. So on the left side, let me show you the underground problems. So the nematode and the weevil, the two pictures on the left side. Basically, in essence, the yield is not less, simply the plants fall over. So it's a problem of uprooting. In the middle, we have the fungal disease Black Sigatoka destroying the leaves. So you get low yields, but also a reduced shelf life. And then on the right side, you see Fusarium, the yellowing. You all are hearing about Panama race 4 destroying the export trade. In Eastern Africa, it's Fusarium race 1, which is basically a problem. It's not a problem for Matoke, but we have to make sure that our hybrids remain resistant. And then on the far right, we have a disease called resulting in bacterial wilt, and therefore plants are dying off. We have found for all those pests and diseases sources of resistance, including bacterial wilt, against all common belief. Next slide, please. So, next, please, Sam. So, we are breeding for resistance, and basically, we have a tremendous challenge. About 6,000 to 7,000 years ago, mankind has selected among the edible banana, among the seed producing bananas, sterile bananas. They're sterile, and we breeders have to turn this into a fertile banana, and in the end, deliver again a sterile banana. Then we have a polyploid. Well, most bananas which are cultivated are triploids, but in the course of the breeding process, we have to bring in diploids, we have to bring in tetraploids, and we have to combine them. So it's quite a challenge to bring all those different ploid levels together. And then next is the perennial. The perennial, you see that. No, please don't go next slide. So we have another challenge, perennial, good for farmers, because once you plant a banana, please go back for the previous slide, then thank you. Once it's in on the farm, you have it for a generation. But for a breeder, it means basically that we have the data coming in very slowly, and from seed to seed, it's about 2 to 3 years. But the mission is very important. 3.3 million people, households depend on the Matoke bananas. More than 10% of the world production is in Eastern Africa. It's even more than the global export rate. And people consume up to half a kilogram per person per day. And if you put it in dollars, it's about $4.3 billion, which is involved. Yeah, next slide. Next, please. So, what are we going to deliver, or what we have delivered? So we have published last week our paper on heterosis in banana, and this is our champion that after 17 years of breeding, we have a 249% yield increase. And so we have tested them in 5 sites in Uganda and Tanzania for 2 to 3 cycles. And now we want to make them available. Now, how do we make them available? Next. Well, we can do that through the classical distribution of planting material, so basically underground branches. But if you do that, we can transmit again all the pests and diseases. And that's why, next, we are in fact going to distribute it through multiplication centers, which are either doing micropropagation on the right side, you see the picture, or through tissue culture work. So this is, in fact, what we are doing, and that's part of another project which I'm not leading. It's led by MEDA. It's a Gates-funded project, and they have done the landscaping in Uganda and Tanzania and found 25 possible partners, and they're going to gradually narrow it down to 6 to 7 for scaling up the material. Yeah, next slide. So the process. Well, you see the sterile banana. Among all the Matoke varieties we've tested, 15 out of 28 produce seeds. And when we say seeds, hooray, less than one seed per bunch. But the potential is 30,000 seeds if you would count the number of ovules. So we only get one seed. And that will not germinate unless we do extract the embryo next. So that which is called basically embryo germination. So we extract the embryo out of the seeds, put it in the lab, and after 2 months of growth, we have it germinating. So this is quite a challenge. But if we are going to move from the triploid level to the tetraploid level, the game is changing. Then instead of having one seed per bunch, we can get more than 1,000 seeds per bunch. Then the pace is accelerating. And we bring in our diploids, then we have about 44 seeds per bunch. And also, embryo germination is much higher. It can go sometimes up to 22%. So basically, the starting point, the land race, is our major bottleneck. And the second one, of course, is the time. Yeah, next. Well, let me go through the breeding process. And I'm going to show you basically a story of 17 years. Next. So we are going to use on the far left side, the Matoke land trace, which is a triploid. And we cross it with a diploid, 2X. And the combination of the 3X with the 2X results in a tetraploid, the 4X. So that's our F1. And then in the next step, and this is already a resistant material, not always for everything. And then we have to move back to triploid level. How do we do that? Well, we are going to cross again the tetraploid with a diploid, and we end up with the triploid, which is sterile. And you see, if you look at the picture, we use twice 2X. The first one is a non-improved diploid. The second one is an improved diploid. That's why we also have a diploid breeding program to accelerate the pace of getting higher yields. Yeah. Next slide. So since in banana, we are able to pollinate every single day because the plant is flowering anytime in the year and we are extracting seeds anytime, we have barcoded everything. So all our plants in the field are barcoded. Our bunches are barcoded, our seeds are barcoded. The tissue culture work, basically, I would say, as a kind of a joke, everything is barcoded except our stuff. It means we're able to follow up what's going on. And it's also not, so we make less mistakes, but in the end, it's easy also to, I would say, for our reporting. Next. Next. So to get there, we have been able to access germplasm, improve germplasm from our Brazilian partners. We are getting material from Australia. We get material from India. The plan is to get material from Malaysia. And as I said already, multi-location evaluation is going on. And of course, very important, we have done the sensory evaluation that we say what is acceptable for our consumers. Yeah, next one. So now to conclude this slide is basically banana breeding has become realistic. Look at the numbers. In 5 years, more than 230,000 seeds, more than 160,000 embryos, more than 10,000 Matoke hybrids. And in the end, we have selected 231. That's all what's happening in the past 5 years, thanks to the support of the Gates Foundation. Next slide. Next one, please. So, let me introduce a few of the all the partners. The hardcore, I would say, the focus is Eastern Africa. So we're working with the Uganda National Program, NARO, the Tanzania Program, TARI, and based at Nelson Mandela in Arusha in Tanzania. And together with IITA, we have basically the platform for the breeding work. But then we need to screen for resistance to fusarium. And that's done, for example, in South Africa at the University of Stellenbosch. But now that we are starting with high numbers thousands of numbers, we have brought in a new partner, which is Wageningen University, which will deal with a large-scale screen for Fusarium. Now, everything is barcoded. That means also we have our field books, and everything goes straight to our MUSA base, our database. And that was developed by Boyce Thompson on the left side in the United States. And the germplasm came from Brazil, Embrapa. It came on the right, let's say, from India, the yellow part, and also from Australia. And now we are developing molecular tools with our Australian partners, with our Malaysian partners, with Kijin, a company. And we are now looking for breeding values. And that's what we're doing with the company in the United States. Yeah, next slide. Next slide, please. So what are we learning from this one? Well, three important things. We have to focus on, on improving the multiplication sites. And this is not about the technology. It's not about tissue culture. It's not about micropropagation. It's about the business attitude. A lot of failures in the past because there's not a business mentality. And the quality control. No varietal mixtures should be allowed anymore. Virus indexing is needed. Yeah, next slide. And then rapid selection. It means basically, let's start using our tools. And first of all, quality has to be evaluated first and not last like we did in the past. And then our molecular tools we have, let's use them. We keep on developing. It's time to start using it when we select. And next slide. So breeding efficiency has to improve. And that means that we have to work on the breeding values, which I mentioned, but also we have now developed camera-based systems for our banana flowering. And what do we see? We pollinate during the day and bananas are flowering at night. So we have to rethink how we are optimizing our pollination system and get more seeds. Yeah, next slide. So we've reorganized our system from phase one to phase two. And basically what does it mean? Then in phase two, pathology is not anymore independent. Pathology is in the service of the breeders. The end users, it's in the service of the breeders. So it's all under the breeding leaders now. And yeah, next slide. And now we have also added next to the pre-breeding and data management seed delivery systems. Yeah, next slide. So coming to the end, this is the last slide. It's a complicated slide and I will not guide you through all this. But the point I want to make, first of all, we're involving a lot of polyploids, different steps. And yeah, next slide. And it means now we have a quality check. So it means that we are fingerprinting our material during the process to avoid any mistakes. Then we have the barcoding system that we know what's going on and also that our field book tells us what to measure at what stage. Next. And then you see that our bioassays are now in place, except one, and it's time to use them now for screening and stop optimizing it. It's time to really start roguing. Next. And then next slide. And then to conclude, we see we have a lot of molecular tools. We have also some maps coming in, and it's time to, in fact, narrow down our work on the different pests and diseases. It's better to have a few good tools than saying many will be developed in the future. So with that one, I would like to conclude. And by concluding, I want to say the following. First of all, thanks to my team, which has been working for so many years on this work. Secondly, I would like to thank the partners, especially our national programs, but also the ones in the other continents. And lastly, I would like to say also thanks to Excellence in Breeding, because since Excellence in Breeding is around and gives so much advice, I feel that I'm not anymore alone with our team. We are basically coached by them, and I'm very grateful, and I'm sure our pace will accelerate in the future. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks so much, Ronnie, for that inspiring presentation, and thanks for all the work that you do on such a challenging crop. What I didn't mention, Ronnie, before your presentation was we did receive close to 30 submissions for Stories of Excellence, and four were selected to be presented at plenary based on online voting, and your story was one of them. So as I'm looking down, I see one question in the chat, and I think we do have only time for one question at this stage, and that comes from Aparna, and she's pointed out that you've reported a very wide yield range from 5 to 30 tons per hectare, and she's curious about what causes such a wide variation in yield in bananas.
Well, in a sense, we have in, and I want to use the case of Uganda, but I can extrapolate to other countries. You have farmers which are producing bananas for self-sufficiency. And these are the farmers which are growing bananas with trees, with coffee, with sweet potato, with maize, a whole range. That means basically first reason for low yield is the low density. The second thing is also because they're self-sufficient, that means not much cash is involved and therefore not much manure is being applied and not much mulch is being applied. And they never apply fertilizer. And the last point is basically planting material goes from farm to farm, so it's always contaminated. And then you have the commercial farms, which are basically eliminating the coffee and the maize and all the other crops. And I'm glad you're moving to monocultures. It's still a mixture of varieties. And these people, they have big cattle ranches, so they're using manure and bring it to the farms. Still, they use basically their own planting material, no tissue culture material, no fertilizer. But these basically are the two extremes of why we have 5 to 30 tons per hectare.
Okay, thanks a lot, Ronnie. And I see another brief question, which I think we can attempt. So Suresh is asking, is banana seed free from viruses?
It depends where you are in the world and depends what variety. If we extrapolate to the genus Musa, to the Musa, anything which has the B genome as an integrated form of a virus, which is called banana streak virus, it's integrated into the genome. So it's there and only expresses when is a stress. While the other viruses, there are another four, are brought in by insects. So in Eastern Africa, at this very moment, we have in the surrounding areas of Tanzania and Uganda, so in the Congo, we have in Malawi, we have bunchitop. It's a killer. You have bunchitop, it's over. Nothing will grow. So that's why we also are preparing our roads for this one. The other is Congo mosaic virus, which is transmitted through wheat. So wheat control is extremely important. So there are some virus issues, and there are DNA viruses and RNA viruses, depending on the case.
Okay, thank you very much, Ron.